So first, I want to say I have a definite conflict of interest. It's not just an appearance of a conflict of interest. It's a definite conflict of interest because the NIAMS is my favorite governmental agency by far. And it also has funded me for many years. So I'm certainly not going to say anything bad about it. But now that you know that conflict of interest, you can take what I say with a grain of salt. So what I'm going to talk about is pemphigus, the improvements in diagnosis and therapy from research over the years. And I'll try to give you a timeline of this, and I'll do it in that sense. So this slide I usually show last. Actually, I usually forget it altogether. And whenever I see Steve in the audience when I give a talk and I forget the slide that gives NIAMS credit, I feel very guilty about it because I'm supposed to use it. So, but I thought in this talk it should definitely go first, not last. And so I really do want to thank NIH, where I worked for many years, actually, not in NIAMS. I actually worked here before, before there was an NIAMS. I worked in the intramural program. Dermatology research was in the National Cancer Institute. But Steve was the chief of the dermatology branch then. And then subsequently, when I moved to University of Pennsylvania, my work's been funded by NIAMS. And much of the other work I'm going to show you today has been funded by NIAMS. And I also want to say that the International Pemphigus and Pemphigoid Foundation's been a wonderful organization, both for helping to fund research and helping patients with pemphigus and pemphigoid have a place they can go when they have questions about their therapy, about their disease. And this has been a really wonderful addition for our patients, I can tell you from firsthand knowledge. So I want to make this major point. There's been a long lag between research and improvement in patient care. And it's very important people understand that. Also important to understand, it's not when people do research on one thing, it often leads to advances in patient care in another, which people had no idea it would. So it's very hard to have directed research exactly at a problem. Often research, if it's good, it may approach that problem and help that problem, but it also may approach other problems too. And I'll try to point that out as well. But I also want to point out that the lag times are getting shorter. And I'm going to take pemphigus as an example of that. So this is a timeline on the top of the, from before 1800 to the present day. And the first thing that was known about pemphigus was the clinical description of pemphigus, which was about 1777 through 1844. In those days, people mainly had clinical description. They didn't do research, they didn't do laboratory, at least in dermatology. They just looked at patients and made diagnoses. And the clinical descriptions of different types of pemphigus, there are two basic types I'm going to discuss today, pemphigus vulgaris and pemphigus foliaceus, were made just by looking at the patient. But it was known that pemphigus, especially of the first type, pemphigus vulgaris, was a terrible, terrible disease. It was known that almost every patient died within 5 years with this disease and died a terrible death. That is no longer true, and that's the most important thing that research has done for us, as far as I'm concerned, and as far as my patients are concerned. Now look at this. It took 100 years for the next step to be made. So before the NIH, it took 100 years to make an advance in a field. There wasn't a concerted effort into doing research in disease. So the next step in pemphigus really was histology, define the types of pemphigus. Histology means doing a skin biopsy and looking at it under the microscope. And by doing that, people were able to differentiate the two major types of pemphigus, pemphigus vulgaris and pemphigus foliaceus, and another disease which was confused with them, which was called pemphigoid. The reason it was called pemphigoid, it was pemphigus-like, because people had trouble differentiating these basic diseases sometimes just on the clinical aspect of the disease. But when histology came about, they could really diagnose these diseases. So what these show is a schematic of a cross-section of the skin, the upper part of the skin called the epidermis. The epidermis is a bunch of cells that line up and sit on a basement membrane. These cells have to be intact. They have to contact each other very closely for your skin to work. In pemphigus vulgaris, they come apart, and the cells come apart deep in this epidermis. In pemphigus foliaceus, they come apart, but they come apart in the more superficial layer. And this simple fact differentiated those two diseases. And even that made a huge difference for patients, because when a patient was found to have pemphigus foliaceus, that had a much better prognosis than pemphigus vulgaris. It was still a bad disease, but the people didn't feel the patient would die within 5 years of the disease. And bullous pemphigoid was different. The whole epidermis came off the bottom, called the dermis, and it came off and the cells stayed together. So this disease was sorted out then. That took 100 years. It was a major advance. This was before NIH, so we can't give NIAMS credit for this advance. Here's what that looks like if you do an actual skin. When we do a biopsy, this is what it looks like, pemphigus vulgaris. There's a big hole in the epidermis deep, and pemphigus foliaceus, there's a hole in the epidermis superficially. So it's very straightforward by histology or by doing a biopsy. Now, another way to look at this is the surface of the skin has to have cells that bind to each other very closely. And in that sense, your skin works very well. It will act as a good barrier. When you think about it, I know I'm prejudiced in this too and have a conflict of interest, but the skin is the best organ of the body. There's no question about it. I'm sorry for those bone people here and those joint people. But the skin's, why is it the best organ? Because when people live to be 100 years old or older, the skin doesn't fail. The skin hardly ever fails as an organ. It still keeps infection out and keeps your fluid in, even when you're 100 years old, even though the skin's exposed to a lot of different things. People tend to die of heart failure, kidney failure, all different kinds of things, but usually not skin failure. But pemphigus is one of the few conditions when people die of skin failure. And the reason they die of that is these cells come apart and they no longer act as the barrier that's necessary for you to live. So the next step, so it's still, even after histology, the prognosis of disease didn't change because there was no effective treatment. Then in the 1950s, people were doing research on the adrenal gland. Who knew the adrenal gland would have anything to do with pemphigus? No one. But then research was supported in the adrenal gland. People discovered corticosteroids for the adrenal gland. They discovered they worked for inflammatory diseases, many of the diseases that you're discussing today. The discovery of prednisone then took place, or corticosteroids, and that made a huge difference to the prognosis of pemphigus. Suddenly, where the five-year survival was 0%, it went to 60 to 70%. And now people would usually be controlled, not always, but usually, but then they'd have side effects of corticosteroid use, and sometimes those resulted in mortality. Then in 1964, a medical student and a scientist at University of Buffalo discovered by immunofluorescence that if you took a piece of skin from a pemphigus patient and you looked for immunoglobulin on the surface of the cells in the epidermis, it was there. It shouldn't be there, but it was. Immunoglobulins are antibodies in your blood that usually fight bacteria infections, things like that. And they shouldn't be attacking or binding to your own skin. But amazingly, in pemphigus, when people took a piece of skin, a biopsy, and looked for that immunoglobulin, here it's shown as green fluorescence on the cell surface of all those keratinocytes or cells in the epidermis. This was a major advance, one in diagnosis, because it gave us another way of diagnosing the disease called immunofluorescence, where you could biopsy the skin and look for the antibodies. But much more important than that, it gave us an understanding that what pemphigus was. It's an autoimmune disease. It was a disease in which antibodies from the immune system attacked your skin. Before that, people had no idea what caused it. They thought it could be a virus, it could be a toxin, it could be anything. They had no idea. But now, with this discovery in 1964, it was known it's an autoimmune disease. So between the clinical description and histology was 100 years. Between histology and immunofluorescence was only 20 years. So when research started to be done and supported in this country, it grew on itself and new discoveries about disease came much quicker. Now, then in about 1982, another little less than 20 years, laboratory models of pemphigus. People would study models of pemphigus in laboratory. And these studies were all supported by NIH. And what they discovered is that these antibodies that were found in the skin actually caused the disease. Now, there are many ways antibodies can cause the disease. They can fix complement. They can release things from cells. They can do all sorts of things. But these lab models discovered that pemphigus is a very, very simple disease. The patient develops an antibody against themselves, which they shouldn't do, and then that antibody directly causes the cells to come apart. It doesn't need anything else. The antibody alone causes this terrible disease. So this showed that pemphigus is caused by antibodies against the skin cells, the epidermal cells. And this was a very important milestone in thinking about therapy, because then we knew that we could try to use therapies directed against the immune system. We didn't know why prednisone worked at this point. And actually, we still aren't sure why prednisone works. We have a pretty good idea, but it may not work directly against the antibody. But these studies show if you want more targeted therapy, if you can either target these antibodies or you can do something to prevent the antibodies from forming, you're going to cure this disease, or you're going to have a good treatment for this disease. That's why this basic science was necessary to come about in 1982. Then what happened is, in about 1991, between 1982 and 1991, molecular biology came about. Before that, in 1982, there was no such thing as molecular biology. And molecular biology is a whole other thing, branch of science that was supported when no one had any idea originally it would be of any help. It turned out to be a huge help in, as you know, many, many diseases. But when molecular biology came about, the molecular cloning of pemphigus antigen could come about. And that allowed us to determine what is it that these antibodies are binding? What is it on the cell that these antibodies are binding to do this terrible thing? And it turned out, by using these antibodies and molecular biology, the actual antigen the antibodies bind was cloned. And it was an amazing situation when that happened, because it was such a beautiful story. The antigen was something that holds cells together. It was something in a part of the cell that was known looking under the electron microscope and under the microscope. It was in something called the desmosome, which was known to help hold cells together, because if you pull a cell apart, you try to pull a cell apart, this desmosome stays bound together. And the antigen that these antibodies were found to bind was called desmoglein, and it was right in that desmosome. It was thought to be the cell adhesion molecule. So here you have a disease in which it's found that an antibody binds to a cell adhesion molecule. The cell adhesion molecule, it causes it not to work anymore, and the cells come apart. So really, it's really simple, but look how many, over 150 years, it took to discover that, with a lot of money. Now, you say, well, how does that help patients? Well, one way it helps is, as I said, there's a way of targeting therapy now. But the other way it helped is, because we could clone this antigen, in 1995, you could make this antigen by recombinant DNA technology, and you could make a test for pemphigus called an ELISA test. And that test now is the most useful test for diagnosing pemphigus, differentiating it from pemphigoid, differentiating the two types of pemphigus. It's much better than immunofluorescence for various reasons, and it's cheaper. So this helped a lot with diagnosis. So then what happened is, since we knew this was an antibody-mediated disease, we want to suppress the antibody, it led to various therapies, because we knew when we used just prednisone alone has a lot of side effects. So as I said, patients did much better, but still, there was a significant mortality. So then we said, well, if we use other immunosuppressives, other things to decrease the amount of antibody, that will help, and it does. So other pemphigus and a lot of other research in immunosuppressives, things that suppress antibodies, led to using these types of immunosuppressives. By those times, I'm thinking of things like azathioprines, cyclophosphamide, things like that. And these immunosuppressives led to greater than 90% five-year survival. because they allowed us to lower the prednisone dose. But then another thing came along, rituximab, which was researched for a completely different reason. First of all, a whole bunch of immunologists spent a whole bunch of years and a whole bunch of money figuring out different antigens on white cells in your body and why they did that. I never really understood. And there were more and more of them, and it used to get me annoyed because I had to remember all these. But it turns out that was very important research because the B cell in your body, the lymphocyte that produces the antibody, has one of these on it. It's called CD20. And if you use an antibody against that called rituximab, it gets rid of the B cells. And if you get rid of the B cells, you get rid of the pemphigus antibody producing cells. And it has worked fabulously in patients that are resistant to everything else. And it has thrown patients into remission. So this was the most recent major advance in treating pemphigus. But it's all based on the past history. So now we're looking for even more targeted and less toxic therapy because you get rid of all the B cells. Actually, people do pretty well, but there are some side effects to that. So if we could get rid of just the important B cells that make these bad antibodies, it would be better. So that's the goal now. I want to show you this in human terms, this timeline. Okay, this is when I started. Luis Diaz gave me this. Luis Diaz works also in pemphigus and pemphigoid. He gave me this recently. Here I am at the beginning. Here he is at the beginning. Okay, here I am at the end, and here he is at the end. So there's a human cost to this research. I just want you to realize that, okay? It's not that simple. Anyway, so I hope I did get the point across that the NIMS has been, and the NIH in general, has been terrific, not only in pemphigus, but this goes for disease after disease after disease. It has made this investment in research has made a huge difference in people's lives. And for that, I'm very grateful. Thank you.